Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take item 3 and consideration of evidence heard in relation to town centres at future meetings in private. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. So our next item of business is the first formal session on our inquiry into Scotland's town centres and retail. This is the committee's second inquiry. We will consider the current condition of Scotland's town centres, particularly after COVID-19. We are interested in looking at new realities for Scottish retail, focusing on e-commerce activity and innovative ways to keep town centres alive. We are interested in looking at what is driving this change and how we can support communities to regenerate their town centres. The committee heard an informal and engagement event last week, and when we engaged with stakeholders across Scotland to hear their views, setting the scene for this inquiry. And the first formal session this morning, I'm going to welcome Professor Lee Sparks, who is Deputy Principal and Professor of Retail Studies, University of Stirling. Good morning. As always, members and witnesses should keep questions and answers as concise as possible, and I invite Professor Sparks to make a short opening statement.
Good morning. Thank you, convener. As you said, I'm Lee Sparks. I'm Professor of Retail Studies and Deputy Principal at the University of Stirling. I'm also Chair of Scotland's Towns Partnership. In 2012-13, I was a member of the National Review of Town Centres, the Fraser Review, which led to the Town Centre Action Plan, Town Centre First and then the Place Principle. More recently, I chaired the review into the Town Centre Action Plan, the report of which was published in February 2021 as a new future for Scotland's town centres. 2021, I was also a member of the Social Renewal Advisory Board and of the Ministerial Group using the recently published Retail Strategy for Scotland. I asked to make a short opening statement of this session in order to cover off a few elements that I believe are important for context and to point to places where written and other contributions are available on some of the points I will make. I've got 8 points, and what I'm about to say is also being posted to my blog in the next few minutes. Firstly, I don't want to inflict academic writing on you, so the best way to get a sense of my research and thoughts is via my blog, stirlingretail.com, and also in the New Future for Scotland's Town Centres report. I would encourage searching the former for discussions and presentations about town centres and changing retail patterns. The latter is a relatively succinct summary of the issues and possible policy directions. I'd make one fundamental distinction for the committee. Town centres and high streets are not interchangeable terms. The latter is the commercial retail subset of the former. Focusing on town centres and retail alone runs some risks in that direction. Secondly, the outcomes we see in town centres are the interactions of complex changes over decades. We spent at least 50 years damaging our town centres. The pandemic accelerated and exacerbated some trends, but these trends themselves are long-standing. They will not be reversed without concerted effort over a number of years, and that effort needs to start with us all agreeing to stop doing harm to our town centres. That's a big ask, covering both new and existing decentralised development. The recent discussion in my blog about issues in Stirling is a good example of some of the topics. Thirdly, over this extended period, we've seen a capital flight from many town centres, not only in retailing, as developments on greenfield sites focused on a car-based economy have been privileged. Such developments are inherently simpler, easier and cheaper to build and operate, being less complex than working in existing multi-use built locations, and produce a higher return on investment. Houses, schools, cinemas, football grounds, offices, retail and so on have all left towns as we have built a disaggregated, decentralised, car-focused economy and increased disparities in society. Fourthly, retail itself has altered over this period, most recently through the twin tracks of rapid and sustained increased penetration of online shopping and the rediscovery of convenience in its many guises. We now have too many shops in the wrong locations, often run and owned by those without local interests at heart. Fifthly, the development of the Town Centre Action Plan in Scotland, followed by Town Centre First, the Place Principle and the Place-Based Investment Programme, often amplified and encouraged by Scotland's Towns Partnership and its partners and members, have positioned Scotland ahead of many countries tackling these long-standing issues. The changing context, as in the climate emergency, community empowerment and community wealth building, Brexit and the pandemic and their impacts on supply chains shown the need to go further and faster. The issues of towns and town centres are complex, deep, long-standing, and require substantive policy development and concerted action by all. Sixthly, a new future for Scotland's towns, with its vision, towns and town centres for the well-being of people, planet and the economy. Towns are for everyone and everyone has a role to play in making their own town and town centre successful. Proposed strengthening Scotland's approach in three areas. A, policy strengthening in the planning area, including a moratorium on out-of-town and decentralised development, combined with a stronger statutory support for town centre first enforcement, not only related to retail. This is being proposed to considerable extent in the draft National Planning Framework 4. B, the use of fiscal levers, where possible, as some are currently reserved, to ensure that the privileging of decentralised development and operations is ended. And C, focused development or policy on getting people to live, work and play in town centres, e.g. on housing, climate green space, that's quality of environment and life, entrepreneurial and economic development, and digital competency, amongst others. Seventh, taking those three areas, we have a focus for activity to allow towns to flourish. We should be resistant to the siren voices asking simplistically for town centres to mimic out-of-town development with free car parking and lower charges. Businesses in other than town centres do need help, but this has to be achieved by a balancing of the costs across this changed economic landscape, and not just in retail. Non-domestic rates require reform, and simply cutting them in town centres will not work, nor provide councils with the finances they require. Governments have to recognise the changed fiscal base that the internet and online activities have produced, and their impacts on the property tax base. The need to respond to the climate emergency requires joined up and sophisticated actions across a range of sectors and activities, and also means tackling existing developments and behaviours that are harming town centres and the planet. Finally, then, there is there a lack of alignment within national and local governments and the wider public sector. Scotland's public sector economy is massive and has the potential to drive town centre change harder and faster, but needs to get its own house in order to do so. If all public investment and money followed the town centre first principle and the place principle, then private capital would soon shift direction, and through levers can be moved in that direction at the same time. There are a lot of emerging policies, examples, planning, housing, economy, retail, climate, and they're in danger of tripping each other up because we are not aligning and harnessing their combined power. This is a real opportunity to have a sustained and major impact at the local level and for local communities. So in summary, towns are socially, culturally, economically inclusive. Environmentally, they are the most sustainable development form and place. The Scottish town is a distinctive feature of our country, adapted for our needs. Towns are unique places, each with their own assets and opportunities. We need leadership and direction to harness their local potential. However, we've neglected them for too long and now need to refocus our energy policy and development on them. We have a sound base, but need to do more to meet the challenges we face. Towns are the potential solution to many of our issues, but we need to get more people, more economic and social diversity, more local ownership, and more pride back into them. This requires us to be bold and rigorous in our approach to development of all forms. Our towns say much about who we are as individuals and as a country. They need to reflect more clearly our aspirations and ambitions. There's no reason why, with a collective will, we can't achieve their renaissance. And thank you for that.
Thank you very much, Professor Sparks. You have identified lots of issues that the committee is interested in. I'm sure there'll be questions that will pick up on aspects of what you've said. Just to say at the start, while there is a town centre and retail inquiry, I think the committee is aware of the difference between the two, and we are reaching out to get views from a wide range across society and everyone who has interest in the future of their town centres, just to make sure we have a rounded report. I'd maybe, first of all, if you can maybe give us, you have outlined some of the work that you've been involved in. I think the most recent was the publication of A New Future for Scotland's Town Centres, which was about a year ago, which you said was a review of the Town Centre Action Plan. Could you, and there's kind of three areas that the report makes, so three big recommendations. Could I mean, it's only a year, and it's been a very difficult year in terms of pandemic and everything else that's been happening. But could you update the committee on if there's any progress or what status this document has? And maybe, you know, you have talked about the complexity of the issues, but are there areas where you think there could be some immediate or, you know, quicker actions that could be taken to ease some of the difficulties and to make some progress in town centres?
In terms of where we are after the report of the New Futures came out last February 2021, there was an initial response from COSLA and from the Scottish Government, which welcomed the report. Over that period, there's been a wide range of consultations and roadshow events, primarily run by Scotland's Downs Partnership. I've not been involved particularly in the detail of those. There is now, my understanding, a agreed position from COSLA and Scottish Government on a Town Centre Action Plan 2. That's my shorthand for the title of it. And I believe that is going through final discussions with COSLA and Scottish Government at the moment, with the aim of hoping to produce that relatively quickly. Clearly, local elections may or may not play some role in the timescale around that. So I'm unsure of the exact timings around the elements that we have. In terms of the second part of your question, I think in terms of thinking of this as quick wins is perhaps a little difficult because of the long-standing complex nature of town centres to start with, and the way in which we've been damaging it for a long period of time. But I think there are sustained things, so it's fighting on all fronts rather than thinking of a very quick win. But getting money back into town centres, getting people having confidence in town centres, getting local authorities to take pride in management of their town centres, I think are really key elements around it. And those are probably where things can happen on the local end. And we see that through some of the bids that we have on the ground, for example. Some of the places that are doing great things locally. And I think it's getting more of that happening in the immediate area. But we have to tackle the big things. And the big things for me are getting planning right, stopping doing harm, bad decisions which damage us, and looking at the behaviours and the patterns we have of existing developments, because those are the things that will really make the change.
And you had outlined in the introduction all the different work streams that are happening and the different plans that are in place. What do you think the committee inquiry should focus on that would bring additional knowledge and you know, proposals to the table? Where do you think the areas we could be bringing value to this discussion on?
I think the final point that I ended on, which was about aligning the various elements, if I look at the retail strategy, for example, from last week, and I look at that, that has to be read across into a range of other policies around Scottish Government, a range of other elements that are going on. And I think it's aligning those and making sure they don't fall over each other becomes a really important thing, clearing that landscape away so that it's very clear what a direction is. So the retail strategy and the industry leadership group that comes out of that is now tasked with looking at Just Work, looking at community wealth building, look at those areas. What does that actually mean in terms of how we think about aspects of transport, how we think about our out-of-town developments, how we think of those sorts of things around our town centres? And I just worry that there are so many moving parts at the moment that actually they will conflict with each other. And I think mapping that landscape and clearing out that vision, I think, would be really helpful.
Thank you. I'm now going to hand over to Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. Professor Spark, one thing this committee, in its preparation for this evidence-taking, has struggled with is to identify a successful town centre regeneration, which we can look at as an example. Some towns have been mentioned, like North Berwick and Peebles. However, from my personal point of view, I see them less as a successful regeneration than perhaps a slightly wealthier area that can sustain the sort of mixed town centre that perhaps might be more attractive. Can you point us to any successful town centre regenerations?
Sorry, I was just making sure I cover off both of the points. Can I start in a slightly different place? Every town is different. All towns are unique. All towns have their own assets and their own populations. And as such, I often worry about an approach that says, that's a great place, copy that. And that's sort of where we get to with some of the regeneration elements that we have. And I think we therefore have to think about what's the local community, what do they require, what are the assets they can build on, that's physical and people assets. And how do we actually see what that means in particular areas? And that gets us away from, I think, some of the what you rightly identified as all of our examples tend to be, oh, that's a nice place and it's a more affluent place. And I think looking at those examples, I don't think helps us too much because the lessons from those aren't great in learning. The lessons have to come from the position and the place itself and the people in the place itself. So I always try and resist saying, go and look at X, or this is a good example, because all of the places are different and they need to build their own different dimensions to their development. I also worry slightly about regeneration as a particular term. It's us doing something to a community in many cases, as opposed to the community and the place actually building from the ground up and saying, what have we actually got here? What do we need here? What is our place like? What are our assets in our place? And I think that if we can get that right, that's much more helpful in seeing it across a range of different towns and a range of different outcomes as a consequence of that. I worry that regeneration, and here's a great example, is a bit too top down.
I think that the term regeneration, certainly in my mind, isn't top down insofar as you cannot have a successful regeneration project in my mind without the community being fully engaged and without all the different elements being brought together. But we're talking here about trying to identify what we should be doing to regenerate these town centres. And if there are examples that we can look at, it's really very helpful. Now, each community is different, but there must be places where regeneration has taken place and where it has been relatively successful. And it's been extremely difficult to identify those.
I'm just going to add, for Professor Spark's information, the committee have commissioned a piece of work to look at international and maybe European examples of where there's been successful regeneration of town centres, and we're awaiting that.
And that, of course, was the second question I was going to ask you, was in relation to pointing out any successful examples elsewhere, particularly, you know, south of the border or in Europe.
Yeah, I understand the dilemma you're on. I'm aware of the work that is being carried out. I think we have to be very careful, again, on the international dimension because of some of the context. It's interesting that we focus on what can we do to regenerate the place. If you go back to the New Future for Town Centres, what we're arguing in that is that you have to look at that much wider context, because that's setting the context for what happens. If it is cheaper, easier to build, develop out of town, and for people to go and get to out of town developments and to carry on doing that, they'll carry on doing it. So we need to balance the whole element. So seeing town centre on its own, and therefore that as the example, I don't think really helps us in that way. So when we look to Europe, I think we need to look at the way in which they've protected their town centres rather more, the way in which out-of-town development has been much more constrained, where they don't build housing in the way that we build housing in the greenfield sites, where they do put rather more into town centres in terms of how they develop housing and different types of housing in town centres. That, I think, is the lessons we should start taking from international comparisons. Way in which they structure the entire ecosystem, not just the retail component or not just the regeneration bit of it, because it sits in that much wider context that we've got. And I think, you know, we need to think of both of those elements together.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I seem to be taking from what you're saying is that virtually we have to reinvent regeneration for each community, for each town. There's no template, there's no example we can look at which would be helpful to us in developing a policy on this.
Yeah, this is where I'll try and argue against myself, I suspect. I think examples are, rather than examples, exemplars might be a better word. The way we start looking at international comparisons, when we start looking at some of the way in which the Netherlands or Scandinavian countries do active travel, do where people live and how that fits together, I think there are exemplars of the type of things we might want to aspire towards. And I think that is a useful exercise to do. And I think that then allows us to talk about those contexts. In terms of what happens in each individual place, I absolutely would state that our towns are different, unique places, and we have to have the community and the community understanding what those assets are and what they can do and what they need and require. Because if we try and put that and impose that, this is the model from over here that works in that place, I think that is imposing regeneration. And I do think we've been doing that in some places over some time.
To make some progress. If there's time, I can bring you back at the end. Gordon MacDonald, to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks, Convener, and morning, Professor Sparks. I wanted to ask you about empty properties. In your opening remarks, you said there were too many shops. Now, given that we've got a whole range of empty properties in our towns and cities, from small independent units to large department stores, how do we tackle the blight of vacant and derelict buildings in our towns and villages?
We do have a large number of vacant properties. I think we need to understand what state they're in, where they're owned. We need a better information base about them, and that has to be done at the local area. I think in terms of what we do with them, we do have too many properties that are in the wrong locations in the sense of how things have changed at the moment, and therefore it's looking at the reuse. Now, saying in X, you know, this type of property you will do Y to, I don't think helps us. So it is again about the local town, the local council and the local community understanding that. But where we're on the periphery of town centres, where those high streets have shrunk, there are opportunities there to bring those back into different uses, whether that's residential use, whether that's other types of uses. For the big units in town centres, we need to think what we can concentrate there. Maybe there's some asset purchases that can be made by authorities, by others. Maybe we can turn those into much more community interest, social interest elements. We need business incubators in a variety of different ways. And it's about thinking what life we can bring back into those properties and where. And there's no easy answer to do this and that'll solve that particular problem, because it will be on that local position. But I think it's a multiple of use, and it's not. I worry about the, you know, we look very much at vacancy rates in terms of retail, because it's very easy to calculate those vacancy rates. I think they're somewhat misleading in some parts, but you can alter vacancy rates in a number of ways, partly by putting businesses into those businesses, but also by taking those businesses out of that sector. I think we need to think through how we want to shape our towns and how we want to shape our places. And in some cases, if you look, you know, you might be in a position where you might want to take some buildings out and put pocket parks in. You might want to put green space in. It depends on what that vision for that town centre is and how those empty properties fit into that vision. Now, that will require some asset transfer, clearly, but I think there is, yeah, we have to recognise that the shape and function of how consumers change and how we live our lives has changed in a variety of ways, and that requires the built infrastructure to change. But that's not to say we can't put assets in there that will drive people into those places. I think the more different types of uses we can get into a town centre, the better.
You touched upon startups, and we heard the evidence last week about Startup Street in Renfrewshire. I mean, how much demand is there from new emerging retailers or specialist retailers for commercial units?
I don't have a good data source to give you this is the number. Anecdotally, from looking around the places that I'm seeing, quite a lot of independent retailers open up businesses over that. And when you think what we've lived through over the last couple of years, that's really quite interesting. I think as multiple retailers have moved out and pulled out of many of our city centres and town centres and have reduced their property portfolio, that is providing an opportunity for independent retailers to step in a variety of different trades. And I'm sensing And that, as I say, from the visual side of it, I'm sensing that there is that demand for those businesses. Now, whether there's a sub-demand of that for more smaller-scale startup test units, so small spaces bringing individual in, or whether there's a different sort of space that's needed that brings them on in a pipeline to that fixed unit at some point, I think that's an interesting question. I don't think we've got really good evidence about that. But at the minute, the sense, and there's some national figures, UK figures out, local data company about the independent startups being at the highest level for a number of years. I think we are seeing that coming through, and that I think that reflects both the withdrawal of some large retailers in some sectors, but I think it also reflects a consumer change around local convenience, authenticity, that I think has come out partly through the pandemic. I wouldn't also, sorry, finally, one other thing, I wouldn't also just talk about retail startups, because I think there are other types of startups as well. We, in Stirling, we've got Codebase. The demand in Codebase is very large. We're looking for a second site around Codebase, and that will spin off people in the town centre. That then adds the footfall, and retail and cafes and others come on the back of that. So I think there's that whole ecosystem to be looked at, not just purely retail.
And you also touched upon the fact that we need to look at the state that some of these buildings are in that are lying vacant. I mean, what are the barriers for that being brought into use? Is it the fact that it's part of an investment portfolio which is not high on people's horizons, or is it a case of there's taxation problems, whether it's VAT on renovations but not on new builds? I mean, what is it that we should be looking at in relation to encouraging people to bring buildings back into use? I mean, the property owners themselves.
Yeah, if we look at that macro part that you started with, and clearly in the new futures report, one of the things, and many others have pointed to the same thing, it is harder and more expensive to do work in town centres than it is in out-of-town development. And VAT, the point you made, is part of that. And we need to really think, if we want to value town centres, how do we actually take the fiscal levers to actually get the behaviours we want? And I think, you know, that point really needs to be emphasised. In terms of the buildings and the property owners, I think it really is about focusing on who these are. In some cases, that's quite difficult to find out, and local authorities struggle to get that. So how do you get them engaged? How do you actually get them to have some sense of ownership within that local community? How do you actually make them do that? And then I think it is about saying, what is the value and asset of this building for this particular place and town? What can we do with this, and how can we help? Because property owners in most cases do want to have buildings that are functioning, are working, and are becoming more profitable for them. The more we can get the whole town centre working together, the more that becomes a benefit to them as much as it does to the town centre as a whole. And that's not true in every case, but I think it is true generally. There's also an issue about some of the historic buildings, and some therefore about how we can get, if you look at, you know, I'm forever walking around town centres looking upwards, looking at all the vacant space we've got up there and wondering, why can't we use that? And I'm not a housing expert in that way. So how do we actually get more of that back into use, a variety of ways? I think that is a really big question, which if you could crack that, I think would help us enormously.
Just on the point of property owners and getting them engaged, I'm conscious that if a home is left empty for more than 12 months, the council can charge double the rate of council tax. Would it force property owners to engage with empty properties if something similar was brought in for non-domestic rates?
I think if you're a property owner and you're going to be threatened in this climate, as in any others, with a rather higher cost base, it probably does help concentrate the mind.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks so much.
Colin Smith, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Professor. Can I look at, I suppose, two twin threats that are facing the town centres? First of all, the challenge of online shopping, and how you think we can, I suppose, support town centres that are faced with, you know, the fact that somebody can sit in their settee at night, you know, at 10 o'clock at night, click their phone a couple of times and have whatever they want delivered to their house the next morning. So why do they need to go into the town centre? How do we deliver more of a level playing field for those businesses that do locate in our town centres when they're faced with that onslaught from online shopping? I'll leave it at that and I'll come to the second threat about the town in a second.
The first thing to say, I think, is we're not going to reinvent the internet. So we're going to have to live with and adjust to online retailing and online business. It's not just retailing. The penetration of online retailing has been growing since the late 1990s. It has been a relentless and steady graph. There's a great graph out of the UK government that shows this. It's been accelerated dramatically in the pandemic and is now above pre-pandemic trends. People find it convenient. They find it beneficial to them. And therefore, I don't see that reversing in the short term. And I don't think people want that to reverse in the short term. So that gives a couple of questions out of that. The first one is that a fair playing field? So are we actually seeing physical properties and online retailing in the same way that we should be? And I think an answer to that is we're not, and we see that through some of the non-domestic rates. We see that through some of the taxation elements, particularly on the larger companies such as Amazon would be a reasonable example of that. And so we need to recognize that the business model has changed, and therefore, how should we react? Because if we continue down the path of doing nothing, then the property tax will end up being higher and higher. People will move more out of property and more onto land. So that process will continue, and that will destroy the property tax base, which is the point I made earlier. So we need to think about how that fits together. The second thing is, how do we then harness what consumers are liking? And I think if we think about what consumers are liking, there are two elements going on. One is they're liking that sense of convenience and ability to do things, and they are in control of it in many ways. But how can we do that for a town centre? It is about making sure that independent businesses, smaller businesses, are online, can deliver. Some of that might be by local delivery, hyper-local delivery possibly. That we actually build that together into place-based systems. So we have a virtual high streets would be a shorthand for that. So how do we make that so the place becomes focused as well? So we build up that sort of brand for the place about what all is on offer. The reason I say that is for the second part. Over the pandemic, consumers began to explore local areas. And they realized that the offer in many local businesses and the local area was something they hadn't really appreciated. And our convenience stores did a fabulous job through the pandemic, as did some other the local opportunities. And there's a real sense of people valuing the local, valuing something different, valuing that experience. And I think we're seeing that growing. So it's that combination of taking the bits of the internet that we can use that people really like, and then taking the place as the element that people value because they value that experience, and focusing on trying to mix those two together as best we can in all of those places. I think that's something we can do, and can do quite reasonably. But I wouldn't want to leave aside that bigger issue around the macro taxation of some of the multinational companies.
So is it therefore the type of retail we support then differently? So you're suggesting that there's probably products that we're never going to compete, a town centre is never going to compete with online, but you seem to be suggesting that it's about changing the retail offer or enhancing what the online companies can't compete with in the town centres, is that?
Yeah, if you think about what do most people value out of internet retailing, they're valuing that sense of convenience, valuing that functionality. So it's the function. A lot of the shopping that we get out of internet retailing is functional shopping. But what can town centres offer if we get town centres right as a consequence? They can offer something that's distinctive and different and unique. And they can offer much more of an experience around it in town centres and in the businesses that are in that town centre. You know, people identify with places. They don't identify necessarily with individual retailers in the same way. And therefore, if we build that place up now, for the businesses that are in that place, how many of them have actually got good internet offers? How many of them are doing that right in the local area? How many are selling the right distinctive area? How much, you know, running a small shop is a tough job. You're competing in all sorts of ways with very big companies who really know what they're doing. So how do you take that point of distinction? How do we get them to use the skills and use the technologies we now have to actually build that offer and collaborate to build that better offer and that sense of distinctiveness place? Because that's what the internet, in its functionality, doesn't quite offer.
I suppose the other big threat is obviously out-of-town developments as well. I mean, in a previous life, I was a councillor in Dumfries covering the town centre. I still have the scars of trying to pursue a town centre-first approach. An example was a big retailer were in the town centre. They wanted a development in an out-of-town area. The council dug their heels in, said no. That retailer pulled out of the town. There was capacity in the town centre, but you know, it was all cost cheaper to build a square box and then out of town development, and they dug their heels and pulled out. And you know, the council got a kicking, if I'm being honest, from residents that retailer had left because the council tried to protect the town centres. It seems to me the town centre first approach is a good idea, but it's just not delivering. I mean, I know there's an element of we're closing the barn door after the horse is bolted because there are so many out-of-town developments, but how do we strengthen that town centre first at a time where the public do quite like out-of-town developments? And also, how do you do it when it's not as much that retailer developing out-of-town, it's the fact that you can get those products in a great big 24-hour supermarket that you used to get in your high street, and you cannot build that big town centre, that big 24-hour supermarket in your town centres as much. There is options, but not as many options. So it's not almost that you can say a town centre first approach. A supermarket's going to say there isn't a site in the town centre for us. We're going out of town. But you know, that's where you then can buy your pots and pans, your clothes and everything else. So how do you strengthen that town centre first approach?
There are a lot of things in that question, so I'll have a go at trying to unpick some of them, if I may. And I recognise the example that you actually that you mentioned, and I mentioned in my introductory remarks about Stirling and the Crookbridge development at Stirling that's going on at the moment, and that is to some extent, a similar example. I think we have to get serious. We have to get serious that out-of-town development has had a cheap ride, and consumers like it, partly because of its convenience, partly because of its cheapness, and partly because of the way it operates. And we have to recognise that if we're serious about climate emergency, serious about changing elements, and serious about town centres, we need to look at out-of-town retailing, and we need to say that actually they need to pay fair price for what they're actually doing. And that is the bigger part of what we've said in A New Future for Scotland's Towns. We can strengthen on a more of a statutory basis town centre first. We should be putting in a moratorium on out-of-town developments, not just retail, but you can start with retailing. And that should be run through NPF 4, through the draft that's going through Parliament at the moment. Those would strengthen those particular elements. But we need to get councils to actually keep the line and say what they're actually going to do and live the talk. You know, we have councils who are saying we are very much committed to tackling the climate emergency and then giving an out-of-town development 3 miles out of the town centre for a large retail supermarket. In the example I'm thinking of, my local example, the way in which they developed and built the site is by putting elements of it together such that the site could never be built in a town centre. If you hadn't put those elements together, every one of those is already in a separate site in a town centre. So there's people playing the system and gaming the system. We also have to get away from doing things like retail impact assessments, which are based on a methodology from 2007, which is now way out of date for what we're doing. And it asks the wrong questions. It asks questions about what's the catchment area. I think we should be much more concerned about what percentage of the population can't get to these developments because they don't have access. The public transport's rubbish. There isn't ability to walk or to cycle to them, any of the active trail elements there, and they don't have car access. And we, as I said, we are socially disadvantaging a lot of people because of the ways we've done all of those things. So we need a structural change. But fundamentally, as a sharp answer to your question, we need the planning authorities, planning regulation, the planning authorities to actually stick to the lines that we're developing and have developed about out-of-town developments and saying we shouldn't be having them, or if we're going to have them, they need to pay the full cost of doing what they're doing. And that involves the VAT question from before, it involves some of the issues around non-domestic rates, and it involves some of the things about the people who are attracted to it by car-borne developments, which we need to start trying to reduce in all sorts of ways.
Can I just touch on I'm just going to say, you made a very valid point about there needs to be a bottom-up approach, that each town is different, and there isn't going to be a solution either from the council or the government. How do you then enable that bottom-up approach to happen? And I know the convener's looking at me, asking me to ask a very short question, and I've asked you a question it could probably give a very long answer to, but I'll leave that there. But I'm just interested in how you then enable that bottom-up approach.
Given your introductory remarks about Dumfries, I'd say you could have a look at Mid-Steeple Quarter and have a look at what they've been doing in Mid-Steeple Quarter and ask them about the barriers.
Okay, so thank
Why
you.
Did it take so long? And what could they have done different? And therefore, how does that possibly give us a clue to what we have to do?
Thank you. We do have a visit planned to Dumfries, so we'll make sure we ask those questions. I'll move to Maggie Chapman, and I'm going to bring in Michelle Thompson and then Fiona Hislop.
Thanks very much, Claire. And good morning, Professor Sparks. Thank you for your comments so far this morning. This is really a follow-on from Colin Smith's questions around planning and community sort of engagement and bottom-up community participation. In your open remarks and in your answer to Colin, you talked about the policy strengthening in planning that's needed, moratorium on out-of-town developments. But you also have spoken about alignment, that the need for alignment across all the different actions, delivery plans, development plans, strategies, and with the understanding of the place principle at its heart. So I suppose I'm interested in, beyond the sort of moratorium that you've talked about, how can we use MPF4 to sort of deliver some of that alignment for us? And I suppose also in the new futures report and this morning you've spoken about our transport systems and the need to shift away from the car, green spaces, town centres as much more than just high streets. So what are the areas of planning reform that are needed if we're looking at a focus on either resilience or recovery, but also on livable town centres where communities feel that they can stay, live, learn, grow, play, all of those things? Big question.
Okay, I'll try and be brief given what was said earlier. MPF4, I think if you look at the local place plans, you look at the various plans that are in there, all of that I think will work if we actually get community engagement. Mm-hmm. And that needs to come, I say, from the ground up. I think there is a bit of a deficit there at the moment. Yeah. I think in many cases it is consultation, but in the very limited sense. And I think some of the things that we would expect councils to do and we would expect communities to do often don't happen. And we heard quite a lot of that in the Social Renewal Advisory Board about groups that were marginalised and the seldom heard voices and the lived experiences were simply ignored as a consequence. And we need to make sure that when we're thinking around how we're developing in the plans in that community, that is absolutely built in from the start. And that becomes the driver for much of what happens at the local area. I think that's a big element. Planning is often seen as that, you know, the moratorium's a good example of a top-down element in one sense of national policy, but what do you do on the local area will actually really make the difference in the local communities. I think we have to start with that. And I do think there is an opportunity through what's happening in the draft MPF4 to get that right and to actually emphasise the community engagement and all of the sort of community empowerment stuff that we've developed over the last 15 years or so. But it's not going to be easy because I think there is a bit of a deficit and a distance there at the moment. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of work to be done at that local area. But taking things like getting communities to understand their area through place standard tools, through some of those sort of actions, and getting different groups, whether it's younger, whether it's older, whether it's whether it's disability groups, very much engaged in how they see the town becomes really quite important. I've now forgotten the second part of your question. I apologise.
No, that's okay. I suppose it was the focus on other reforms, planning reforms, and I suppose linked to that actually planning powers around resilience, recovery and livability of our town centres.
Yeah. As I said in answer to one of the other questions, I'm not, and livability is a good example, I'm not a housing expert, and therefore the detail of how we can bring some of those spaces back mm-hmm. is beyond my knowledge. But I think, given we can see it elsewhere, other countries, as I said earlier, I don't think it should be beyond our wit to actually understand that and actually cut through that. I think the concept we haven't talked about so far this morning, about 20-minute neighbourhoods, becomes very important in terms of those planning elements and how we actually then take those lived experiences, which are very difficult at the minute, and then think about the 20-minute neighbourhoods. How do we get people to live, to work, possibly to have those functions in those locations that are really different? So how do we build that density, but gentle density and quality of life density within that? And that, I think, is where planning has a bit of work to do. But I think there may be exemplars from elsewhere in terms of 20-minute neighbours that we could look at. And I am aware we will need to be careful in thinking about the principles of that. 20-minute neighbourhoods works quite nicely in urban areas, but when you apply that to a rural area or an island area, it becomes more difficult. So it's the principles of a livability and quality of life and assets where people need them at particular times. That becomes the principles we should be engaged in those 20-minute elements. I think that's where we need to put quite a lot of focus.
Okay, thank you. I'll leave it there, given.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Michelle Thompson, who'll be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Morning. Good morning. Thank you for all your contributions so far. It's been very interesting. You said earlier that international comparisons are useful, and I'd like to just get a bit more thought from you in terms of what parallels you see with what the Scottish Government is able to do, given that we understand that there's limitations in fiscal levers. That's one question. And the second question about that is, what are the differences you see in terms of how change is undertaken? And you've touched on some of the challenges that we have here, local engagement and so on. But I'm interested in your knowledge of what's happened elsewhere in these two key areas. Thank you.
I'm not sure I've got enough detailed knowledge to do justice to the questions, in that I think if we take exemplars from international situations, we need to understand that context, as I tried to argue previously. That context, of course, has been built up over a considerable amount of time in the way those societies and elements work. And therefore, I am quite interested in some of the Scandinavian elements, particularly around the transport part of it, about how they actually integrate the transport bits. I think that is a learning and a parallel that I think we could actually benefit from in reasonably straightforward. And I see in the ambitions we have in Scotland, I think that would be a relatively easy thing to say, how do we actually do that? And I see some of that happening at the local level at the moment. I think change in many of those countries is more participative. I think it is more built from the ground up. I think there is more of a sense of local ownership. I put that in inverted commas, of the place and the pride of the place. And I just fear at the minute that whilst I can criticise all the things that have gone on that have damaged our town centres, we've also had a bit of neglect from the people who are running our town centres, in the sense of councils, if they run town centres in that way, how they manage them. And I think the vision for many of our town centres hasn't necessarily been there. I think when you look at places elsewhere, there's a much clearer identity for that place and a sense of place. I think we've lost that a little bit in the way that we've elsewhere over the last 20 or 30 years. I don't think those are great answers to your questions, but I think you get hopefully get a sense of what I'm trying to grasp there.
And I suppose, I mean, all the way through this, you're highlighting the complexity. And given your opening remarks that for 50 years we've been getting this position, I suppose what the challenge for all these committee things is to really make a difference. And I'm accepting that it will take the time to make a difference, given, you know, that you highlight perhaps a lack of engagement, a lack of experience. So if it was you and we were able to do something fairly radical, how long will it take us? I mean, what expectations should we be setting?
The one thing we shouldn't be setting is that we can do something and expect an answer in 2 years' time. Having said that, if we look at some places that are making the first steps and are doing things, I think we are seeing places that are growing and having that sense of growth. So if we were able to do the radical things that we would quite like to do, I think you could see quite a big shift within a decade. But that's the sort of minimum timescale we're talking about. And if we think about some of the broader patterns, whether it's climate emergency, that was in 2040, those elements, that is the sort of big timescales we have to think about. And I know that's not often a comfortable answer for politicians, but we work on a very different timescale for obvious reasons. But I think that is where we have to be realistic. We have spent 50 years disaggregating, decentralizing all of those things and putting stuff back together again, as we all know, is rather more difficult than breaking it apart in the first place. But I think once it gets a momentum and once it's clear, to go back to one of the earlier questions, once it becomes clear that we're serious, that we're not going to allow these things to carry on harming places, I think the momentum shifts, and it'll actually shift more quickly than we think.
Thank you. Thank you, Kavina.
Thank you. Fiona Hislop.
Thank you and good morning, and thank you very much for your insight. I'm particularly interested in how we might view our approach to this inquiry, and whether we take that deficit model of towns are a problem to be solved, or are towns a solution for modern living, and your perspective that towns are unique, every town has a story. So what do you think is the role of culture and events and tourism and leisure in the, where it's the identity aspect you've just talked about, or the experience of town centres?
One of the things in Scotland's Towns Partnership and our partners we fought against is we tried desperately, we may not succeed every time, of focusing on that deficit element. We built a tool to look at places, so understanding Scotland's places, USP. And one of the things we were desperate not to do, because basically it's a set of data on all the towns across Scotland, what we were desperately trying not to do was allow comparisons across towns, because what you get into, if you're not careful, is the pejorative descriptors, worst town in Scotland, or worst town in so-and-so. And you see, in England, you get Grimsby gets it, or Hartlepool gets it, or someone gets it. It does no one any good. You know, towns are an asset. They are the solution to many of the things that we need to do within Scotland. And I think we have real strengths in them. They're just rather hidden at the moment. So very much around the solution part rather than the deficit model. And I will fight against having that bad descriptors of places, you know, post-industrial wasteland, really doesn't help anyone living there or helps us to do things around them. To turn to the second part of the question, cultural events, tourism, leisure, absolutely vital. If we think about town centres, they're about experience. If we can bring those experiences into town centres, whether that's the cultural events, whether it's theatre, whether it's cinema, whether it's other sorts of cultural events, museums, art galleries, and building up those assets which tell a story about a place. Whether we think around events, just sitting in Stirling and thinking about the writing event, Bloody Scotland, and the people who come in as part of that and the energy that comes around that, that brings both the people around that, it brings an exposure to the particular place. If you think about the things, and I will use an example here about Paisley and the City of Culture and their bid for that, and all the energy that came out of that and what they're now doing around that, and what that means for the high street, what that means they could put in with other assets, building on what they've got, all of these are absolutely vital. Our towns, in many cases, have historical assets, not always. We need to use those in better ways. We need to just tell that story of places, and it'll vary from place to place, but all of those are absolutely required. And most towns have that. It's not obvious in some towns, but I think when you start picking under it, there's some great stories and great assets in those forms that we have.
And my second question now is in relation to, I suppose, what we now currently are seeing on our high streets. And I represent West Lothian. It's one of the youngest constituencies in Scotland. We have a lot of hairdressers, beauty salons, etc. I think the people of West Lothian want to look good, but I also get complaints from some constituents that, is that all we have? But that's an experience. That is part of a leisure experience. It's bringing people onto the high street who can then, obviously, you know, it's footfall, you know, can buy other things. So how should we look at that dimension? Because it's very real in many towns in Scotland.
Yeah, I think what it points to is a word I did use in the opening remarks, which is about diversity. Mm-hmm. And I think what that reaction is, and I recognise that in different towns across Scotland, it's a reaction to a dominance of a particular type of development in a place. We've seen it with charity shops, we've seen it with bookmakers, I'm fully aware we see it with hairdressers, though no personal experience, obviously. In terms of that, I think we just need to think about, and it goes back to partly another question, how do we free up some of the use classes that we have? How do we free up how we change some of those uses? What do we allow between things? Is there something about too many elements are a bad thing in a small location? But if we can build variety, that takes care of itself to some degree. And you're right, these are part of, you know, people use those facilities, use those businesses. They're often then going to use other businesses on the high street or in the town centre at the same time. And it's, that then drives the footfall. We just need more of those, but more diversity of them, not more of the same. And just thinking through how we can try and create the conditions for that.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Jamie Halko-Johnson.
Good morning, and very interesting, Professor Sparks. Thanks very much indeed. I've got, I'm conscious of time, but I've got three kind of questions all on different areas. So if I could start with my Highlands and Islands region, there are lots of communities that are very reliant on tourism and the tourist market visiting. That's not always of great benefit or the same benefit to, say, local residents in terms of, you know, what the facilities are available for them. So can I ask how important the balance between it is providing that balance between kind of visitors to a town centre from maybe far in a field, but also local residents and also those residents within the kind of commutable or easily visitable area, such as those that might go in for kind of shopping and other facilities?
Yeah, very real problem, clearly, in parts of Scotland and also other parts of the UK as well. It's important. If what you've pointed to there are really three categories of consumers, you've pointed to the local residents, the slightly wider afield residents, and then the visitors to it. And the word you used, I think, is the most important word in that, is what's the balance? But if we don't have the facilities for local residents, for the things that they need for the year-round experience, then I think you won't get the latter ones necessarily either. So it is, I see them in a sort of priority. We want to attract the spend in, but it is that balance. But if we haven't got that local community sense to start with, we've lost something, and that then it eventually degrades the visitor experience.
Right, thank you very much. My second question, which does actually link a little bit into that, talked about the kind of role of the public sector. We've talked about the role of the public sector in this session. I suppose I'd like to be the more direct role of the public sector in terms of presence on in our town centres. So it might well be, you know, council outreach points or the police or meeting rooms, town halls, or public toilets, which of course can be a bit. How important is the presence of public sector bodies and organisations within town centres to provide that kind of base, as it were, of local community kind of visitation requirements. So slightly complicated.
Yeah, I think there are a couple of dimensions to that. One is that sense of these are assets and they therefore do attract different people for different reasons at different times. And there's a range of reasons in what you example there. So I think that is important because if we stick them in inaccessible places, then how does that fit with our ideas around 20 million neighbours? How does that fit with making life easier for people to use in town centres? And town centres provide that environmental sustainability, environmental in the broadest sense, so it becomes much more socially inclusive. So we need those elements there. But I think there's a second element as well. That is around a statement of evidence. We've taken a lot of these things away, and councils have hidden themselves, moved away, and not just councils, I'll take all of the elements. What does that say if you're a resident of that place, if you're, those assets are not visible? It says they've not got confidence in your town centre, so why should I have confidence in my town centre? There is a sense of presence, and developing that asset as a sense of local pride as a consequence, whether it's a community hub, whether it's a workspace, whether it's shared spaces in new ways we have to think about that councils and all of us have to work with. But that sense of something that is part of the community, that the public sector is making that investment as well, I think is really important symbolically as well as physically for the visitor side of it.
Yeah, we see certainly in some places in the Highlands, we've seen those, even some of the public service, public sector areas move to out of town, which you know, does obviously has an impact. My last question was something that came up last week in the roundtable session that we did. It was around, you know, there are a number of successful bid projects across Scotland and some perhaps less successful. But one of the concerns raised was that in those communities that perhaps aren't big enough to or not unable to form a bid, a lot falls on volunteers. And a lot of these volunteers are already business people who, you rightly pointed out, are already very busy themselves. They have to operate amongst timescales that can be difficult to work within, complicated form filling, etc., to access public funds and support. How can we better support those smaller communities who are looking to improve their town centres, improve their retail offering, provide better local infrastructure? How can we ensure that they're better supported in doing that if they can't, for example, afford a development office or somebody to take on as a full-time role?
I think in terms of the bid model, there are, as you rightly say, some successful examples. There are others that have been. I think there is an issue around scale, particularly in some of the ones that we've had. And recognising that, it might be that we've got to have some sort of concept around a super bid. And we've got scale towns that are actually put together in the sense of a bid, and we manage them in those ways. There may be opportunities there. Development trust in the smaller places and development trust model in Scotland is really quite successful. So we've got a really big example. It doesn't get away from some of your volunteer elements to it. One of the things in the new Futures for Scotland Town Centres was that we need to think, where we are looking at community assets, we need to think, there's often a feeling of communities can buy a building and what you then do. And it's the same with a bid in one sense. The bid committee gets it, or gets all the stuff up, it gets it running, it gets it through the ballot, it wins the ballot, and now it's got to do the work. But you've had 4 years of trying to get it and you're exhausted. So there is something about the revenue streams around these and making sure that when we invest at different levels, it's not just the capital investment, that we're actually thinking, how do we get this onto a sustainable basis to start with? And then it'll take off, or it won't take off. Hopefully more of them will. And I think that becomes important, and that may help with some of the experience and some of the business side of it, because we need those people to volunteer. We need those skills as part of it. As you rightly say, if they're doing it always on top of their day job and it's the only thing and they're getting all the pressure, it isn't really that sustainable. So we need to build that sustainability part of it.
It's very interesting what you say, because there's a number of, as Fiona has been talking about, the cultural aspects where perhaps the desire for the local communities to take on an aspect, but it's that long term making it kind of work financially. Thank you very much. Thanks, Camilla.
Thank you. Can I just ask a brief question? Jamie referred to the round tables we had last week, and it's maybe not unexpected. We did hear a lot of comments about business rates and requests for reform of business rates. You might be aware that Fraser Avallander published a recent report into the small business bonus scheme. I don't know if you have any reflections or comments on the role that business rates plays in some of the challenges and how we might resolve some of the frustrations we hear from the sector.
Yeah, I think in terms of non-domestic rates, we have a system that primarily started out in 16-something, and we're still trying to run it in a changed economy and changed setting, and I don't think that's long-term sustainable. The two elements we've seen recently, the Barclay Review really was only what it could look at, and was constrained in terms of the things that have happened subsequently, both the pandemic and also declaration of climate emergency and elements. So I think we need to rethink non-domestic rates from the ground up. And we need to ask a question about non-domestic rates in terms of, if we are serious about climate emergency, serious about town centres, how does and should the non-domestic rate system be structured so as to support those ambitions? At the minute, it clearly isn't. And that is a fundamentally big question. I think we can't wait for Barclay to work through for the next few years. We really ought to be looking at that seriously now. And the challenge of online came into that as well, and the challenge of out of town. The Fraser Avallander report on the small business bonus scheme, I saw the headlines, but I've not had a chance to read it. And therefore, it would be unfair of me to comment on it in detail at the minute. The point I took from the bit I did see in the headlines and what businesses tell me, small businesses do value it. How much it's a real difference, I think, is an interesting question, and how much of it could be targeted better and perhaps better focused around particular types of businesses in particular parts of town centres, I think is another question I think we will have to come to. But non-domestic rates, as they currently are an issue.
Thank you. I'm now going to invite Alistair Burnett to ask a question, and that should be the final question in the session, I think.
Thank you very much, convener. Just a couple of questions. One is sort of a very general one, and one very specific. It's been fascinating hearing from you this morning. You've clearly been at the centre of this subject for a considerable time, and in the room with government for some of that. You say there needs to be substantive policy development. How hopeful are you of actually seeing this? And you know, if it was to happen shortly, how long before we could actually see improvements? I'll come to my second question after that.
How hopeful am I? I'm originally Welsh, so I have a strong stream of pessimism in me just to start with. But I am hopeful. I think there has been a recognition, accelerated by the pandemic, that place is really very important to people. It is part of their identity. It's part of the identity of the country as well. And it is that identity, pride, feeling, all of the assets and all the things that we've talked about, I think, is there. I am therefore hopeful, because I think more people are recognising that what we've got currently isn't fair. It is socially divisive, it is economically divisive, and we've got all of those issues, and there is a better way of doing lots of things we're doing. And therefore, I do feel that we're at a point now that we can make real change and real progress on this. How long will that take? I sort of tried to answer that earlier. It is not easy, because we're putting together something that we've spent half a century breaking apart. So I don't underestimate the challenge. But I have the privilege of working in a university, and therefore I am surrounded a lot of the time by very young people with their aspirations and their desires and a very different outlook on life and what they want to see. And I am encouraged by what they want and the drive and energy they're bringing to things as a consequence of that, and the way they do want to change the world for a better place. I do think that we can make it happen, and perhaps quicker than I think of sometimes in my more darkly Welsh moments.
related to that. I'm sure we'll all share hope for the future on that. The second question, very specifically, and just expanding on, we talked about, I think it was Gordon, we long talked about empty properties. We heard at our session last week of specific issues where you have flats above shops, with both of them being empty. And obviously you then have a conflation of different issues affecting both, which maybe doubles or exponentially increases the failure of occupancy in these places. I just wondered, did you have any, have you seen much of this elsewhere? Because we were talking place up in Aberdeenshire at the time last week. Are you aware of this, and do you have any specific solutions for that kind of problem?
The answer to the latter part is I don't have any good solutions. It's not an area of real expertise for me. So I'm difficult to come up with anything and say, do this and that will solve the problem. And it has been a problem for quite a long time. I'm old enough to remember campaigns in the 1980s about living over the shop. So this has been around for a while and we don't seem to have cracked it. Going back to a very early question from the convener, someone could actually cut through this and actually devise what we need to do. I think it would be a real benefit because we've got to get more people living back in our town centres in a variety of different types for a whole series of reasons. And the wasted space we have is really bad. Do I recognise what you've said? Yes, I do. I think in terms of empty space above higher levels, I see it a lot in many of our town centres where the shops are occupied. But I fully recognise you will find places where all of that is, where the shops and the residences above are not. It is an area where I think if we could get it right, there's a really big win there, a really big win. But I don't have a good solution for you, I'm afraid.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, convener. No more questions.
Thank you. That brings us to the end of the evidence session. Professor Sparks, you have shared many areas of expertise with us this morning and we appreciate the time you have given us. That concludes the public part of the meeting and we now move into private session.
Thank you.